campaign. I'm using the Genesys RPG system. It's been really great so far. This campaign is based on the novel The Man in the High Castle and the very good, I think, Amazon show by the same title. The name of this campaign is The Grasshopper Lies Heavy, and this is Chapter 5. Quick disclaimer, you're going to hear some RP from Nazis, from bad guys, from good guys. We're always on the side of the good guys in this game. And the only thing we have to do with Nazis is killing Nazis. So, let's take it away. Zypher, who plays Chandra Nadu, is running a little late, so he's going to join us in session. But first of all, we have some introductions. John Smith sits alone in his high tower. It's late, but people are still up. They are still glued to their new color television sets brought to them directly thanks to the German engineering. John Smith sips scotch. There's only half a finger of it left. He drinks, swallowing, feeling the heat in his belly. As a secretary chimes in. Mr. Smith, the envoy from Berlin is here to see you. Send him in, Alice. My pleasure, Reichsmarschall. Mr. Smith sits in a deep leather chair. It's of excellent make, and he runs his fingers nervously over the armrests before standing to meet the Almighty in reception. He's now out of attention as the two men walk in. Edgar Hoover is wearing a neat black suit. Heinrich Himmler is adorned in the fantastic regalia of the Reich. Hoover speaks first. John Smith gives a Roman salute and stands at attention. Hail Hitler! Hail Hitler, Hoover says. Then Heinrich begins to speak.
We had a pleasant enough flight, Reichsmarschall. But I dare say the city is quiet. It's the kind of quiet that rarely screams out loud. I trust there will be no civil unrest during our Yarnall celebrations.
He turns back to Smith. He walks to the window, and from the window you can see brilliant winter city lights arrayed before him under Himmler's command.
There will be no problems, Reichsfuhrer, says John Smith. It's the will of the American people to reclaim their Aryan legacy.
Very well, says Himmler, turning again. The darkness of the city silhouettes his short but powerful frame.
Journalists sometimes die unexpectedly, but gentlemen of North Carolina, Reichsmarschall Smith, you will the brave actions of your son. Why would you have him killed?
Oh, I did not, replied Smith. According to police reports, he hung himself. It was suicide. He was an opium addict.
Himmler smiles smugly. This is why you are Reichsmarschall of the American Reich. An iron will.
He pauses.
I expect arrangements have been made for I and Mr. Hoover to be aboard the vessel in the harbor. We are much anticipating the destruction of that depraved statue.
Smith smiles. You are known. Arrangements have been made. No tickets needed. He's joking, but doesn't sound funny.
Excellent, Reichsmarschall, Himmler says.
He and Hoover turn to go.
We are going to an excellent steakhouse just off Times Square. Care to join us?
No, says Smith. I have a broadcast in a few minutes. As you said, I need to clear the air, make things very simple for the American people.
Ah,
Yes, finished Himmler. Your work is never done. Have a pleasant evening, Reichsmarschall. Smith clicks his heels and throws up a crisp Roman salute. Hail Hitler! He watches as they leave. After thinking a while, John Smith grits his teeth. He pours a little more scotch, but only a little. He's to be on the air soon, and his wits must be sharp. His eyes must be bright, he must be convincing, he must be commanding. He looks up as a woman with a kind but nondescript face walks into the room. She's attractive but plain, buxom and well-built. Smith smiles. Ah, Helen! The mother of my children. John Smith leaves his chair and hugs his wife. Well? She asks. Well, what? What we talked about. Ah, it's not the time, Helen. Tonight is about appearances. Our boy will be vindicated. We just must wait. We must wait until the time is right. Helen herself now pours a scotch. She drinks it with eagerness unbecoming of the wife of Reichsmarschall Smith. You'll do it. I know you will. Smith nods silently. The broadcasters are in the next room. Care to join me? Helen puts on the face like plastic. Sure, dear. Let's act. Smith walks with his wife into the next room, where waiting for him is an army of microphones and TV cameras. All across New York and the Northeast, John Smith's voice can be heard. His face can be seen. He inspires confidence, and the people listen. On TVs across the land can be seen Smith's face. On radios, his voice rings clear. Greetings, citizens of the American Reich. This is Reich Marshal John Smith. Hail Hitler and happy Yard Null. I come to you this evening with good tidings. Preparations for our New Year's ceremony are coming along nicely. Whether you plan to celebrate in Times Square, New Berlin Gardens, or in New York Harbor, you're certain to enjoy yourself, and you're certain to witness the majesty that our Führer has bestowed upon North America. Then he continues, industry is booming. Joblessness in the Northeast and Appalachia are at an all-time low. Every citizen has bread to eat. Every woman has a baby to care for. Our numbers are growing, and we inch ever closer to the thousand-year vision our Führer has gifted to us. Things are good. We have cause to celebrate this year, Null. Then he says, his eyes becoming more stern, but now I must address some worrisome rumors. I am sad to say that Gerald Harris of the Raleigh Reporter was recently reported dead. According to police, his demise was ruled a homicide or suicide. I remind you, we have no reason to doubt this. Mr. Harris's loss of life was tragic, but he was an opium addict, and we know such a path of degeneracy leads only to death. Some have insinuated I was involved because of a recent interview where my late son was mentioned. First, I would never interfere with the free press of America. Some traditions of our country remain intact. Second, I would never be offended by mention of my son. Thomas was a bright and shining boy, but above all, he was loyal to the Reich, and he made the ultimate sacrifice. So go forward this year, Null, and know that I am with you. America is with you. Berlin is with you. And let us usher in this new age for the Reich. Hail Hitler! All across America, people salute their TVs. Smith leaves. He goes with his wife away from the cameras. That was excellent acting, husband, Helen says. Was it? Says John. His smile is like a wolf. Teeth lifts, lifeless. It was. What? What, are you having doubts? Helen says. The Reichsmarschall begins to answer, then says, I'm sorry, Helen. I'm very busy. I will be home late. We'll talk in the morning. Alan Diedrich is supposed to come over to discuss arrangements for the harbor. Helen blinks, smiles. Yes, dear, and she exits. Smith watches her leave. More scotch, more thinking. More darkness as he looks out his window over the sea of lights. Let me find something that actually works here. And so the scene changes. Abel Tinson and Chandra Naidu walk out of the apartment just before midnight. Outside, the rain has turned to sleet, and then flurries of snow are drifting down, white and translucent against the backdrop of neon lights in downtown New York. Abel Tinson, with his top coat and his hat with the bullet holes, pulls it tight against his collar, shutting out the cold. And on his right walks Chandra Naidu. They have a few blocks to go before meeting Jack Moffat at the appointed rendezvous point. It's been one hell of a night, Chandra. One hell of a night. If we see this through and get to the neutral zone, we'll have tales for years, friend. Tales for years. Maybe you'll even have a couple babies, huh? They'd like to hear some stories about you. You want to be a hero, son. Cipher.
Can you guys hear me?
No, you're muted.
Can you guys hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry. This is Abel and Chandra talking to each other as they walk up to meet Jack, correct?
Yeah, they're a block or two away.
Okay. Chandra, as they leave the hotel, the first thing Chandra would have done is he told Abel to kind of wait by the stairs, given that Abel is didn't want to put Abel out. He took the bed sheets and everything all rolled up into almost like a, the old school traveling rucksack style, tied up with knots. He would have gone to the top of the hotel, and once on the roof, he would have thrown that bundled up bed sheets as far as he could throw, maybe onto the roof of the next building. After that, he would have made his way down, caught up with Abel, and proceeded to meet up with Jack. Along the way, Chandra has been silent. He has been mulling and thinking of the events that have occurred in the past few hours. He is unhappy that Francis put such a proposition in front of Ruth and nearly derailing the whole mission. He wished Henry would not have followed him to that bar. But most of all, he wishes that every plan he makes sticks, for he feels for every problem he solves, 10 more appear. And the cycle doesn't seem to stop. When Abel talks about babies in the future, Chandra just grunts. Abel, you speak about brightness. I cannot see it yet, my friend. I just hope it's there for people like us once this journey is done. I've read many a book in my time. And one thing I've always come to the realization, when war is done, the guns are laid to rest. People like you and me, my friend, have no place in decent society. The question is, when the bright future is upon us, if we can really turn off, quieten our inner demons.
You're a deep man, Mr. Nadu. I'd say there'd be a couple different schools along that line of thinking. I have no doubt you heard me talking about my family. I could go back to playing baseball in the backyard and having grill outs. That man Jack, though, Jack Moffat, he still has that inner demon. It bubbles up from time to time, and, well, in times like this, that demon can sometimes be useful to let out of the bottle, if you know what I mean. But yeah, I understand what you're saying. But know that us Americans, yeah, it may seem like we're quote-unquote pacified, as the Reichsmarschall talks on the television, and that bastard Himmler sends out his radio addresses. There's always something under the surface, something clawing to the top. We're going to knight the powder keg, friend. We're going to knight the powder keg. And he just looks up into the sky and hopes, just says, let's just hope this weather doesn't put out the flame.
Yes, Abel. That is what I'm hoping. That is what I'm hoping, that we can ignite New York. You see, I have a long way to go, my friend. Miles to go before I can sleep. This is just the beginning. I'm hoping if things turn out well here, you and your countrymen will wake up and push back. And if we are successful here, what is to say I can't take the same back home to my country?
Well, that day way. Comes. If that day comes, and I'm not dead, well, maybe I'll travel with you.
That would be mighty fine of you, Mr. Tinson. I have many a wonder to show you back home. We might not have baseball, but we have something similar. You might even like it.
I've tried to learn the rules of cricket. You hit the ball the wrong way.
Indeed it does. It's the bounce of the pitcher. That's the problem.
Oh, yeah. It's the bounce that's what matters. Like I say to my wife. Oh, okay, Chandra. It should be up here.
Abel kind of takes a cigar out of his coat. The tip of it's burnt. He clips off the tip with a cigar cutter and puts it to his lips and lights it up, and you can smell that heavy fragrance of cigar. As you get closer and closer, you can tell that it's not a situation of martial law, but definitely increased police presence. Down one alleyway, you see like a fire and hear some sirens, and you see some firefighters kind of putting it out. There's some shouting and a gunshot, and it kind of goes away and dies down. So even though there's this veneer of peace and tranquility tonight, there's still this underlying sense of unrest.
As they're walking up, Chandra would like to take stock of his surroundings and just make sure that, they're not being followed, or there are no unsavory characters apart from themselves hiding in the shadow.
Okay. Why don't you give me a check for that?
Perception?
Yes. It's going to be average, It's dark out, so give yourself a setback. And do you have any talents or anything that would give you bonuses?
1 minute. Just make sure. Talents. It's just a brilliant, unremarkable knack for it. Rapidly. No, nothing for this.
Alright.
What? Why is there so many?
You fail, but you have four advantages. So you don't notice anything. Anything unusual near the alleyway, mm-hmm. at all, and I'll give you those advantages later on.
Cool. Yeah. So as they're walking, you know, Chandra nods, listens to Abel, and he tries to keep his eyes about. Yes, Jack should be around the corner. I hope he was able to get away from the Gestapo.
Oh, lead the way, Chandra. Let's get out of this wind. I hope he's okay as well. He's going to be a good guy to have on our side, Mr. Nadu. Like I said, that demon. He can be a powerful ally at time to time.
Indeed. And with that, Chandra quickens his pace, rounding the corner. Kind of keeping his eyes peeled to see if he can spot Jack.
You see Jack kind of smoking a cigarette kind of just around the corner as you see this here. He's looking at a piece of graffiti. It looks like it's a white field with a red bar underneath and a kind of a half moon or a crescent sun kind of rising over the horizon. And he sees Abel and Chandra kind of walk down the alleyway. His right hand is in his coat, like you might have a pistol there. But then his manner kind of eases up as he recognizes you guys and says, "Well, it's about time you made it. Looky here. New graffiti. Right across from the swastika. What'd I tell you, Abel? We ain't all alone. Some of the youngins that ain't part of the Hitler Youth. Well, I got a gut feeling they're on our side, friend. All right, Chandra. Thanks for coming to meet me."
Chandra looks around again, and he... One minute. Sorry. So as Chandra sees Jack, he nods to him. "Sorry, Mr. Moffat, I was held up with an unforeseen circumstance. Well, it's been taken care of. Things are all right for now. But we do not have much time. Gentlemen, I must first begin by saying thank you. Thank you for... how does one put this? Humoring me and agreeing to my somewhat far-fetched scheme." And Chandra has never told him about the movie or why they are here, correct?
No. Well, I think you did mention it.
Okay.
Is that right, Sim? I think you mentioned it.
But I didn't give them details of what the movie is about, right?
So
he looks at both of them. He says, "The reason that I wish to do what I am planning is not just destroy a symbol by itself, but make a point, make a seen a show that the Reich is not all-powerful, that men, women, when they stand up to it, the Reich can be pushed back. My associates and I, you met one of them, both of you, Mr. Henry, we have a movie, and I know I've talked about this, but I never gave you the details. This moving picture reel that we have shows an extremely interesting outcome to the war that the world has just faced. An outcome that throws into question everything that we see today. The movie doesn't seem to be, or at least the production value is of extremely high quality. So it is hard to say if it is a fake or if it's a reality. But what it shows is the Allies winning. And he makes a pause to look at both Tinson and Moffat. The British, the Americans, the Russians, all of us winning the war, pushing back the Reich, and but that's not the reality as it is today. And I cannot make much of that movie, but I feel if the masses see it, they may begin to question, even if it may seem a fake. And as they begin to question, they see the building go up in flames. It adds a certain panache to the situation, wouldn't you say? And Chandra pauses for them to kind of take that information in.
What are you talking about, Chandra? Abel says. I knew you was crazy. But this talk about films, that's far-fetched stuff. What are you going to do? How are you going to get in front of that many eyes? Listen, I'm willing to take a gander, but... Hell, I'm willing to blow up the symbol you're talking about, but... It sounds like some extra special sauce you're talking about.
It is, my friend Abel, it is. That is why you saw me jump through hoops, and me and my associates do all we could to keep that fracas back in the hotel room under wraps. That lady you saw weeping, she is Frances Dietrich. She is releasing a movie extolling the Reich and its virtues on the eve of Yad Nal. We have convinced her about our cause in joining us. She has seen this alternate movie that I talk about, and she, just like I and my associates, and God willing, the people of New York on the eve of Yad Nal, were all taken aback. She has promised she can do whatever she can to get that movie to be shown instead. My associates who are with her right now will do what they can to make sure that happens. We, on the other hand, need to make sure that the building and the symbol go up in flame in tandem.
That is some special sauce, says Abel. And I surmise as much her identity. And Jack's kind of listening in to the whole situation kind of being described about what went down in the hotel room. I'm sure the conversation may hit on that. He says, well, this is quite a big operation. I'm trained and very skilled at blowing stuff up, but this is going to take tact, Mr. Nadu.
And that is why I'm with you, gentlemen. We shall do what we can. And my associates and Mrs. Dietrich. And he kind of stops himself. Well, I guess it's Miss Dietrich now. Will do what they can to show the alternate movie to the masses. We don't have to worry about that for now. It's in their hands. We just have to keep our end of the bargain. But I've thought much about this, and I've decided to tell you both the full story. Which means we are at a point of no return. If any of us get captured, I don't think a bright future is what we should be looking for, gentlemen.
Jack Moffat shakes his head and looks down at the snow and looks up to the poster on the wall.
I hear you, Mr. Nadeau. I don't intend to be captured. If that looks to be the case, I might find myself sucking on the muzzle of a gun.
And Chandra nods and he says, likewise.
All right, Chandra. Where to next? I ain't gonna go back to that bar. Place is still crawling with creeps. I think a few tried to track me out of there, but I think I lost them. You have a place to go, get out of this wetness and this cold?
I do not. Well, I had a place, but now it's been compromised, and I dare not go back there.
Oh, yeah. The bloodbath. How could I forget? Abel says. Takes a drag off of a cigar, and you see the orange ember of it glow heavily in the dark of the alley.
Yeah, good call. We shouldn't go back there. We got one day to plan, as I see it. One day to put the word out to the boys, Jack. One day to coordinate this and plan. We definitely need some sort of safe house, somewhere to go.
Chandra thinks for a while. The only other contact I have is the cab guy who put me in touch with you, Jack, but I wish not to drag him into this. Is there no other place we could hide out for the night, at least get our bearings right and come tomorrow morning? Proceed with fresh minds and a fresh pair of eyes.
I guess we could do that. Jack, you're welcome to stay at my flat. It's kind of a shithole, but there's a bed. We can cuddle together to keep each other warm. Or you can sleep on the sleeping bag on the floor. Jack says, I'm not going to be caught sleeping next to you, Abel. Floor will be just fine.
And Jack kind of looks at Chandra. So, how am I supposed to contact you, Mr. Nadeau?
That's a good question. Wait, so did Abel just invite Jack to the apartment, correct?
Abel just is saying that that Jack could just stay with him tonight. And then they can all meet with you tomorrow morning.
All right. Yeah, so Chandra thinks about it. Gentlemen, sometimes one must throw caution to the wind for a bit. Tomorrow, 9 a.m., let's meet by the building. There must be surely a cafe there. We shall meet in the cafe.
Ah, yeah.
There is a little coffee joint there. A lot of the SS officers walking around, though. That no, ain't no thing. This is a big city. Even some of your brown skin nature. They can even be seen from time to time. Clerical duties and whatnot.
Indeed. We shall just see each other there. And then rendezvous at a different point. It's a clear landmark. We can all meet there out in the open, but we shall not talk to each other. Once we have made eye contact, we shall proceed to leave the area, and I shall follow you two gentlemen to a place where you two deem fit and safe that we can talk more.
Okay, okay. Well, it's about 12:30 now. What do you say we head back to my flat, Jack? We can have a nightcap and talk about this a bit. Kind of looks at him and says, ah, I'll take you up on that. Anytime you're buying, count me in. They start to walk out of the alleyway.
Chandra nods to both of them. Tomorrow morning, gentlemen.
As they start to walk out, Jack, this is your four advantages. As they start to walk out, Jack just, you know, does the left hand reach across Chandra and Abel's chest. Stop! Stop! Right there! Stop in your tracks! And right before they come out of the alley, they can see that they're still in the gloom. They can see kind of across the street two kind of police officers kind of emerge from the shadows. They don't seem to be aware of Chandra and Abel or Jack, but seem to be kind of searching in and out of alleyways, knocking on doors, that sort of thing. A meeting with lower level police officers kind of run up to them and then leave. And Jack says, those are the two creeps that followed me from the bar. I did lose them, but looks like they doubled back looking for us. And with that, I think we're going to just switch scenes for a little bit. And we had Henry and Ruth in a car heading over to the Dietrich's apartment. If that works even. Yeah, it does. So, you guys are heading, you know, you were downtown New York, near the party safe house. Skylark's Tavern is the place that Jack owns. And you're heading down Fifth Avenue, down towards the Dietrich's apartment, which is kind of a swanky area. And as you're on the way there, it's kind of the same situation that Chandra saw. It's mostly peaceful, increased police presence. Here and there, you see small scuffles breaking out that are violently put down by GNR police with batons. You see a couple dumpster fires. Some of them haven't even been put out by the fire department yet. They just kind of burn, putting off this black smoke that goes up into the sky. Once you go into like the area around Fifth Avenue, Central Park, there's all these security checkpoints that you start to run into. And it's quite likely that Henry kind of tried to go around and that sort of thing, but the security presence is just too much. And Henry's likely driving with Ruth and Francis in the car as well. And poor Mr. Dead Alan Dietrich is likely in the trunk. So you can take it from there.
So we're approaching a checkpoint at this point, right?
Yeah, not there yet, but just kind of driving along.
I don't think there's any way around these checkpoints.
Yeah. Ruth sits up a bit in her seat and brings her hands together slightly. It does look like it's... hopefully we'll be able to get to some fairly quickly.
I'm not liking it. You know what, that Henry's going to reach inside his coat and pull out his gun, make sure to rack it, you know, kind of as a letting the wheel go so car goes straight for real quick. And then he tucks it under his leg. Just in case.
Of course. So, I feel like if we were to get into a gunfight now, it would not be the best.
No. Being caught at all is not going to be the best. With Alan in the trunk.
Nein. Well, let's put on my play face and she'll peek back at Francis. Are you going to be okay? Can you hold it together until we are at the apartment?
Francis is sitting in the back seat and she looks up into the rearview mirror and can see Ruth's eyes and says, yes, I've acted the parts many times. I think I can get past these boys in blue.
Good.
After all, we have certain advantages.
Yes, we can try and charm them with our German heritage.
Absolutely. Just don't let them look in the trunk. Okay, Henry?
Well, if they look in the trunk, they're going to be looking at a few bullets.
If the bullets start to fly, Henry, we are as good as dead.
Yeah, well, let's just hope it don't come to that.
Alright. Come, faces.
What is that?
Calm faces. Oh.
Yes. Calm faces, alright. And with that, and having to reach into his coat and pull out a cigarette, Lucky Strike, put it on his lips and light it. Take a big old deep drag. Well, here's hoping for the best.
Yeah, yes. Definitely hoping. I just want this night to be over.
It's probably about 11 o'clock at this point. And several cars in front of you have been let through the barricade on Fifth Avenue. You see the black vehicle in front of you get let through, and one of the police officers kind of salutes him and goes on his way. One of the police officers goes over to a security checkpoint, writes something down on a piece of paper, and the barricade comes back up again after the car has passed. He kind of stands up. He has a whistle and blows his whistle. Beep! Kind of holds his right hand towards you. This way! This way!
And we'll go ahead and follow directions, pulling up towards him.
Points at Henry and kind of inches him a little bit closer. Then the first cop kind of goes over to the door by Henry and knocks on the window. Makes the symbol to roll down the window. Sir?
Henry will nod his head yeah and roll down the window. Ah, good evening, officers.
Good evening, sir. And he puts his head, the missus and Mrs. Friend? Sister? Oh, sir. A lucky man. I'd like nothing more than to get you on your way. If I could have some identification and your destination, please.
Okay, simply, I was at the party with Miss Dietrich in the back and Miss Wolf over here. Let me reach inside and get my identification. And, he's going to reach inside and pat it down. Tell me I might have left it. He reaches in to his other pockets. One second, officer. I'm looking for it. I may have misplaced it.
Okay, sir. Take all the time you need, but do not take all the time you need. You can see behind you, and he holds up a flashlight. There's three or four kind of cars that have kind of piled up behind you, and it's New York City, so that happens. A couple horns start to honk. Hurry up, buddy! You're holding up the line!
Busy night tonight, huh?
Yeah, it's a busy night. Fucking yarn all. And the police officer just kind of rolls his eyes.
Yes. Quite the celebration tonight. And he's going to keep patting himself down. Not 100% sure if I have an ID on him. So he's going to reach in his pocket and I guess pull out some papers and stuff and keep fumbling around.
At this point, the officer starts to get a little suspicious and points his flashlight into the car. Have you been drinking, sir? As you know, public drunkenness has been highly discouraged by the Reichsmarshal. Will not be tolerated. And I do have a quota to meet, so could you please step out of the vehicle, sir?
Yes. No. I
apologize, officer. Hello. And she'll have her own kind of identification just in her hands, just in case. I apologize. We are in a little bit of a rush. And she'll kind of look over to Henry and look over to the police officer. Is this,
And, Ruth looks up as well and... officer, can I be of assistance? Making her accent extremely thick. Germans kind of hold quite a bit of sway. Says, I'm sorry, Fraulein, just doing my job here. Need some identification and a destination, please. We have a list of all the apartments on the street. Gotta check the list. Check it twice, if you know what I mean. Ah, yeah, yes. My name is Franz Dietrich. I live at 2323 West 5th Avenue. Yes, okay. Very well, could you stay here, Miss Dietrich? And she says, I do appreciate you not bothering my friend's husband. He does imbibe some, but he's quite not out of his wits. He's quite sober. Isn't that right, Henry?
Ah, yes. I mean, after all, it is yard now.
Yeah, and we are indeed entrusting him to get us back to Miss Dietrich's place.
Alright, let me just go check this against the list, and I'll be right back. Sir, I still would like you to step out of the car and put your hands on the hood of the vehicle, please.
Ah, sure thing, sure thing. So he's walking away, right?
Yeah, he's walking away, and he's motioning over to his buddy. Hey, Jerry, can you come stand with this car while I go make a security check?
I'm going to dump my gun down the side of the door. Not the door, but the seat on his right side away from the door. Mm-hmm. And he's also, as he's motioning to get out, he's going to grab the pistol that he took from the apartment as well and drop it as well. And then slide out the car.
Okay. I want you to give me average deception check with a... So it can be deception or skullduggery with a setback.
Yeah, I'm not sure I'm very proficient in either one of those.
Oh, okay. No.
Get ready for a surprise. I am armed to the teeth. All right. So, difficulty would be average with a setback, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, No concerns.
Success with one threat. So yeah, give yourself two strains. And so what happens is, as you get out, you kind of let the gun slide down into the car, and it kind of clatter. And one of them comes to rest against your leg, and you kind of kick it, and it like goes back into the car and clatters onto the floor, kind of in front of Franz in the back. She kind of moves her high heel and slides it under the seat out of the officer's line of sight. And Jerry's kind of coming over, keeping an eye on things as his buddy is making the security check. And what he does, though, is he's kind of watching and making a small talk and says, "So what do you folks have planned for the celebration?"
For the celebration, we are now. Too much all social gathering. What about yourself?
Work.
Yes, I can imagine. Never stops, does it?
Nope, never stops.
Yeah, and then he's gonna look around. So how are things so far tonight? Is everything quiet?
So far, there's been a couple reports of hooligans starting fires, that sort of thing. But, you know, it's New York City. Young kids.
Yeah. Some things never change, do they?
Nope. Don't change.
And you mind if I grab a cigarette, officer?
No, not at all. Keep your hands where I can see him, please, though.
Oh, no problem. And he's going to pull open his jacket, you know, where the cigarettes would be. And I'm just going to have to reach in the inside here. I'll pull it out slowly so you can see it. And he's going to pull cigarettes out slowly and show it to him. Would you happen to want one?
No, sir. Don't smoke. One of the five officers in the city who don't.
Yes. He's going to put a cigarette in his mouth and light it. And he looks back at the traffic. And so how busy you expect it to be the whole night? It's going to be busy like this, or is it going to be taper off at some point?
Usually most of the drunks are in bed by 2 o'clock, and then that horn starts to blow again. Beep, 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 behind you. And says, "Excuse me, let me step away to deal with this asshole for a second."
I'll be standing here.
And Jerry walks away from your vehicle and approaches the red car behind you. And you can kind of hear him talking in loud voices. And he has his flashlight kind of shining in the door. You can hear him say, "You'll pass the barricade in order of arrival. If I hear another word out of you, you're going downtown." He doesn't anything back. And on his way back to your car, his flashlight kind of swings over the bumper of the vehicle. And he sees something on the corner of the bumper dripping from the trunk. And goes over there and puts his flashlight on it and says, "Hey, Will! Hey, Will, is that address checking out?" "Yeah, sure thing. Just about ready to head back. We'll get these fine people on their way. Miss Dietrich, sorry for the delay." You might say, "No, wait, just come over here. Take a look at this."
So are they both heading behind the car right now?
Yeah, they're both heading behind the car.
Henry's going to get close to the window and stick his hand in the window, hoping that somebody will hand him a pistol.
Ruth is going to see the hand, and she'll reach down quickly the side of the his seat and feeling around for the gun.
No.
And
nothing like a gunfight with bare hands.
Yeah, she finds the gun.
And she hands it to him. And are the keys still in the vehicle?
Yeah, they're still in the mission.
She hands it to Henry and basically signals towards the keys and for trying to point him towards her, point at the seat, and point ahead.
Oh, just to get in. Henry, not really looking. He's going to slide the gun to his back and kind of do a double look. Because he wasn't trying to look into the car. He was just kind of standing by the window. So the motion kind of drew his attention a little bit.
So, Franz says, you want me to go to the driver's seat? I'm not doing it. They see anything back there. Just talk them out of it.
Okay.
Before the school starts shooting people.
Okay. And Ruth is going to roll down her own window, kind of stick her head out. Is there a problem, officers?
And Will kind of says, yes, ma'am, there is a problem. I would like each of you to exit the vehicle, please, with your hands up. Sir, hands where I can see him. I apologize. You're going to have to lose that cigarette.
Oh, no problem. Then he'll...
And Francis starts to get out of the car.
Is there something the matter, officers?
Yeah, I would like you to open the trunk, please.
Oh, open the trunk, you say? Okay.
Absolutely, sir. Do you have the keys?
Yeah, they're in the ignition. Can I reach in and grab them?
Hey, Jerry, why don't you grab the keys from the ignition for this gentleman? And Jerry kind of walks around the other side of the car, reaches in and grabs them, starts to walk back with the keys. Getting ready to open the trunk.
As the officer's walking back, at this point, Henry's gonna draw his pistol from behind him. Oh, everything's going to hell. They're about to see a dead Alan. Nobody wants to see a dead Alan. But he's not necessarily going to point it yet. It's just going to be in his hand at the side.
Okay. Okay, I want you to do a cool check. Hard difficulty. With a setback. I mean, I think that'd be pretty tough to do. It's a very tense situation. Let's see what you do. And you have points to use.
Yeah, I'm going to say I'm going to use a story point to upgrade.
Okay.
So there would be an upgrade. Yeah, setback one. Is it upgrade proficiency?
Or is it next? It should be like upgrade check, I think it should say.
Upgrade difficult. Downgrade difficult. Nope, there was no upgrade.
Yeah, okay. So cool. I'll let you roll it again here. Since that was really bad. Upgrade proficiency is what it's called.
Alright. How many can I upgrade them by?
It's just one.
Alright. Fucking...
Oh my goodness.
3 foot. So give yourself one strain.
One strain.
Yep. And he's gonna make the same type of check.
Is it a...
Cool.
Is it a social check?
Hard. Well, this is if he sees him, if he gets his gun up before the police officer, because he did see him. And I'm going to give him a boost from all that threat. One setback. A fail, but two advantages. Okay. So what's able to happen is... So you draw your weapon out. He sees you,
he gets his weapon out behind you, but he's able to say, Jerry, he's got a gun!
Fuck me. So what's the next move now? Is there...
So, you're going to go first in the initiative order. You're going to go first automatically, okay? And the two policemen are going to go after you. And then Ruth and Francis can do whatever they want. Francis just kind of... What the fuck, Henry?
Yeah, really?
Well, you know, we decided to hide a dead body in the trunk. So, what kind of initiative would it be? Cool or vigilance?
You don't need to roll initiative because the order is just going to be Henry, okay. Then the two police. And I'll let Ruth go first as well. So I'll let you guys go first before then.
Go ahead, Ruth. You want to go first?
You're going first. You're the one with the gun.
So nervous. Just had to bring guns out. Alright, in that case, I'm gonna, because I think at this point we are beyond discussion. Which one would be the one that's heading back to, well, he yelled for Jerry. Jerry's the one by the trunk, right?
Yep, they're both right in front of you, basically. They're both in easy range with a boost.
Okay, I hit the one that's directly, like, kind of in front, but a little bit to the left, not on the, like, if you look at a trunk, the right side of that trunk. And then the difficulty, average?
Nope, easy. With one boost. All right, what's that look as you pop him in the head? And you kill him.
Seeing that they're obviously about to open the trunk and find a dead Alan, Henry's going to call on all his reserve of all the training he's had. And he's just, as the cops notice his gun, he's just not even going to hesitate. He's going to... Not even, it's going to be a little bit of a frown as he raises the gun up and takes a shot at the first one. And then he's just, as the gun goes, he's going to look over to the left.
And you see the other cop kind of pulling his weapon up, obviously, and starting to aim it in your direction. But you have another PC slot left before he goes.
So, Ruth, being severely panicked by weapons being raised, weapons being fired. How close is the other officer to her?
Close. I mean, within 10 feet.
Okay. Since he's kind of in the midst of raising his gun at the moment, and it worked so successfully with Alan last time, she's going to attempts to kind of latch onto that arm and just kind of point the gun away from Henry and try to distract and just kind of make him unbalanced while Henry can get prepared for another shot.
Gotcha. I think that's going to be the same type of check, hard with a setback.
Okay, and sorry, what...
And you can upgrade it too if you would like to use a story point.
Oh, I'm going to. I'm sorry, which skill was that again?
Let's do. Probably brawl.
Okay.
I know it's not your best, but.
Oh, no.
That's what it would be.
I'm sorry, easy or?
It'd be hard with the setback.
And with. Is it one boost?
One a setback dice.
One setback. And then upgrade.
upgrade proficiency.
That probably
is right. Failure.
Yeah.
Yep. So you lunge at him. You are not a huge person though, and he's able to kind of grab you with his left arm and kind of forearm shiver and push you down to the ground at his feet. He says, "Stay there, or you're going to get it next, lady."
Henry.
And the policeman, one maneuver to pull it out, its weapon, the other one to aim, and so he's going to fire at Henry. His light pistol. So you're going to take 6 minus, what's your soak? Your soak is 1, Henry?
Yep.
So you're going to take 5 damage. So just add that to your sheet.
Oops, I just minimized. I am so nervous.
So 5 wounds. What's your wound threshold?
14.
Oh, that's good. That's pretty tough.
I beefed myself up for combat last time.
Yeah. right in the middle of New York City. So that happens. We're back to the top of the order. You do see, though, from down the street at another security checkpoint, two more cops emerge. And they're on some sort of radios, and you can kind of hear them yelling into the radios as they're down the street. They're in long range right now, though. The cars behind you start to yell and scream, and we're I'm going to move back to the scene in the end. This is much more quiet.
Oh, man.
Chandra looks to both Abel and Jack. Well, this is a mighty fine pickle we are in. So they are coming up from behind us or ahead of us?
They're kind of in that street, like maybe like at the mouth of the alley across the street of you. They don't have any clue you're there. They're just kind of searching the area because, for example, maybe they were trailing Jack earlier, but Jack lost them.
Okay.
And now they're kind of doubling back, just kind of searching the area.
Okay. So he looks to both Abel and Jack. Well, gentlemen. He pulls out his wallet, takes the cash, and puts it in the sock of his right foot. He hands the wallet to Abel. From the back of his pocket, he pulls out his Luger pistol and hands it to Jack. Gentlemen, if you could keep this with you for the night, and I shall get it from you tomorrow morning.
I know my bar just got raided, Chandra, but I ain't gonna take your money.
No,
what do you have in mind?
The money goes into my
okay.
Yeah, my sock on the right foot. Well, if those two are after you, Jack, then you need to leave this alleyway. But before you do, they need their attention drawn somewhere else. A brown man walking the nights of New York City who seemed to have been mugged might catch their attention long enough, giving you the time to slip away.
Okay, okay. I see what you got in mind, but Chandra, you're taking a risk dealing with these thugs. They see you've been mugged, they're just as likely to blame you as get you help.
The other choice is to walk away and they see us. Are they kind of turning around the corner, or if we walk away, they would see us right now?
They probably see you. You know, they're just kind of like being vigilant.
Correct. So it's the two of you getting away or the three of us getting caught. At max.
Okay, okay. I guess this is as good a plan as any. Abel's talking about. I guess I can go with you, Jack, and I'll hang back a few paces. If things start to go south, Chandra, maybe I can be said mugger. Cause another distraction, and I've never been one that's fleet on my feet, if you know what I mean, but I'm no stranger to fisticuffs.
Gentlemen, gentlemen, please. You know as much as I do. They have no reason to suspect me. In the end, what's important is that building go up in flame. If I'm not there tomorrow, so be it. But that building must go up in flames. Somewhere across the city, my friends are doing what they can to run that movie on the appointed hour. I cannot let them fail. At max, these thugs might take my money, might beat me up a little more and leave me in the alley. No worse than I've experienced before.
Okay. Well, I trust you, Chandra. I want to trust you. You're a soldier. You have a soldier's mind. You're not willing to... You're not afraid to take chances. Like I said before, you got some set of cojones on you, Mr. Nadu.
I appreciate your compliments, Jack. Be safe, you both. I shall see you tomorrow at 9 a.m.
Both Abel and Jack kind of give Chandra a little salute. And they kind of hang back in the shadow just a little bit so they can kind of sneak out around the corner. Mixes.
Before they're about to leave, Jack taps, Chandra taps Jack's shoulder, and then he kind of points to his cheek. If you'd be so kind, Mr. Moffat.
I don't like Chandra doing this, Chandra, but like I said, make sacrifices to the part. So you want him just to crack you across the jaw?
Yep.
He rears back and just cracks you right across to your left cheekbone with his right fist. It immediately starts to swell up a little bit. And you can barely see out of the left eye and kind of see a haze of blood as blood starts to stream down your face.
Oh, sorry. Didn't mean to do the job so well.
Chandra just kind of holds his jaw and nods his head, and then kind of with his hands gestures them to start walking away. How much wound or strain should I take from that?
You can give yourself one rune. Actually, that could be more of a strain. I'll just give yourself two strains.
Two strain? Okay.
Yeah.
Perfect. So, as they start walking away into the shadow, Chandra changes his gait. Hunches a lot more, starts limping, holds his jaw, and starts walking towards the thugs.
Let's see. Can do. All right, so... Gosh, man. None of my tracks work. Sorry, guys. I know this one works. So, Chandra walks out of the alley and blood is dripping from his left eye, kind of down his cheek into the snow. And he sees the two policemen ahead of him.
He nods at them, kind of pauses, and stands and kind of stands in front of them, blocking their view into the alley.
They kind of see somebody, see a shadowy figure in the mouth of the alley, and one of the policemen kind of breaks out a heavy black flashlight, shines into the alley. You! Stop! Who goes there? Let me see your hands!
Chandra gingerly raises his hands up in the air.
Alright. Come forward. Come forward. Don't do anything funny now. It's been a tense night. Very cold. My temper's a little bit on edge.
Yes, officer. Chandra starts walking slowly with his hands raised towards them.
What the hell? What the hell happened to you, sir? Hey, Tom! Hey, Tom, get over here! And the other kind of policeman seems to be higher ranking. Walks over and they take a look at Chandra and say, hell, what happened?
Oh, I'm sorry to cause you any disturbance, officers. I was walking down the alley, minding my own business. I was attacked by a group of men. They seemed to be setting fires to things. They saw me and the color of my skin, and they chose to relieve me of my belongings.
They kind of look at each other, and Thomas kind of looks at the lower ranking officer. Ah, you gotta deal with this piece of shit. He ain't worth the paperwork. I'm gonna go back to that bar, see if anything's turned up. I'll check in on you on the normal frequency. Got it? Got it. He trots off and leaves Chandra with the single police officer. He's looking at his face. Says, hey, Thomas is partially right. You know nobody's going to help you in this part of town. Is that right? Yeah. He kind of looks around. We're trying to track down someone dangerous. If it was a gang of youths that did this to you?
Yes, officer. But, you see, my kind, my people, we train ourselves to look down on the ground, not look up. All I know is they were young men, but I didn't get a close look. I dare not look at such people, if you know what I mean, sir. I do not expect any help, just to be on my way and get back home in one piece.
Well, you got one thing right. There's been lots of them youths roving the streets late at night, setting fires, causing all sort of ruckus. Hitler Youth. My young nephew's part of them. Bunch of whack jobs, if you ask me, but you know how things go downtown these days. As a matter of fact, what's a person of color doing so late at night by yourself? Just can't wrap my head around that.
I miss my country, sir. Miss my people. New Year's time is often a lonely time for someone like me. I choose to shake my loneliness by just walking the streets and Maybe the cool air would push sad thoughts away, if you know what I mean. But I guess things have changed. Yes, as you say, a lot more chaos and anarchy around here now. It was foolish of me. I apologize.
As long as you don't do it again, but don't know if that quite makes sense to me. You need to stay indoors, man. Especially with skin like that. Don't be careful, somebody's going to make it into a lamp. I've been hearing some horror stories come out of Europe.
Yes, officer. You speak of wisdom. And sometimes the loneliness makes me do... How do I put this? Stupid things.
Okay. Why don't you give me a deception check?
Mm-hmm.
It would just be average, because again, he doesn't have any reason to suspect you, but give yourself a setback, because it would be odd to find some Indian guy out here by himself at night.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you have that thing for deception, too? Let me look
at it. Yeah, I do. It says those boxes, setbacks, two setbacks can be disregarded.
Okay, so just an average check for you, and then give yourself a boost.
Oh, okay, you want me to roll it again?
Oh, did you roll already?
Yeah, I rolled already.
So that's a threat, so it'd be fail with a threat. So without that setback, so that setback would have been disregarded, right?
Yeah, two setbacks get disregarded.
Right, so it's a setback dice. So the way I use it, so if that check only had one setback dice,
uh-huh,
and your talent would have given you to remove two,
mm-hmm,
it kind of starts to go the other way, right? So you would have given yourself a boost. So I'm going to disregard that setback icon, which is the threat, but even without that setback, it still would have been a straight failure roll. So just roll me a single boost die. You just make any check and add a boost to it, and we'll just look at the blue one.
Oh, okay. Oh, sorry.
And we're going to hope it's a success.
Single boost die.
Two advantages. So he doesn't... He doesn't necessarily believe you, but he's not willing to carry you off to jail just yet. And he says, he kind of looks you over. You have any sort of identification, sir? Why don't you follow me back to the cruiser? I need to check a few things.
Indeed, officer. As I said, all my belongings were really sorry. This hurts a little too much when I speak. All my belongings were relieved from my person when the youths attacked. But I would be happy to follow you to your cruiser.
Kind of says under his breath, that's fucking convenient. And out of the corner of your eye, Chandra, as he leads you over towards his cruiser, you do see Able One Jack kind of scurry around the corner and disappear into the shadows. And he kind of gets to the cruiser and says, I'd like you to put your hands on the hood of the vehicle, please. I'm going to call this in.
Indeed, officer, as you say. And at that, Chandra puts his hands on the vehicle.
What he does is kind of gets inside his car. He has a radio in there, and radios into the precinct, and you hear him chatting for a while. Hey, this is Officer O'Malley. Got someone down here just off of Times Square. Looks like he's taking a beating. Indian gentleman.
by itself. Negative, sir. No identification. What do you advise? Okay. I'll bring him in. I get it. The chief wants heads. The browner the better. Yes, sir. All right, sir. I'd like you to come with me and step into the vehicle.
As you say, officer. When who's around this person in this area right now? Is he and the police guy by themselves?
Yeah, he's with himself. The other guy that was with him kind of took off and walked down the street still looking for Jack.
Okay, sounds good. Hold on. Okay. As you say, officer. So how does this look? Is he opening the door for Chandra to get into the back of the car?
So typically what he would do, he would kind of open the door, and he would ask you to kind of put your hands behind his back so he could cuff you before you got into the cruiser.
Mm-hmm.
So he's holding the door open. Sounds like you're being pretty compliant up to this point.
Mm-hmm.
So one eye is open. He's kind of getting the cuffs off his belt with his other hand.
Okay. What is on his person?
He has his gun. He has a nightstick that you can see. And then he has a cuff that he's reaching for.
Okay. So Chandra starts limping slowly. Excuse my pace, officer. The young gentleman really did a number on me.
And I apologize, sir. We'll get you somewhere warm tonight, even if it is in a jail cell.
And as he gets closer, Chandra is going to basically jump on him. And does the gun look accessible, or is it kind of locked into the holster versus the nightstick?
Yep, it's got a holster with a locking mechanism over it that a typical policeman would have, like a button locking mechanism.
Okay, so then he's going to go for the nightstick.
All right, give me a brawl with a setback.
Okay. Easy, average?
It'd be average.
And I will use a story point for this.
Very good.
What does that do?
So you're going to upgrade proficiency times one.
Okay, so let me do this again. So brawl, average, setback, one. Upgrade proficiency, one. Downgrade proficiency, no. Upgrade difficulty, no. Downgrade difficulty, no.
Oh, man. Failure with the threat. So you clatter to the ground. You miss his nightstick. And you're rolling around with him. You're rolling around. He reaches his hand, makes sure his weapon's still there, makes sure his nightstick is still there. And he's able to kind of come up on top of you and kind of has his forearm across your neck. And he's reaching for his cruiser again to try to find that radio, but he just can't get there. So he's on top of you, and he can't do much, but next turn he's going to leap off of you and probably call for backup.
Sure.
And give yourself a strain with that, with a threat.
Sure.
What's your strain threshold?
14.
Oh, geez. You're mentally tough. All right, so you're up next. What are you doing?
I'm going to push him off and go after the nightstick again.
All right, I'll give you one more attempt with that same check.
Mm-hmm. Actually, no, just push him off and run off into the night.
All right. So I think that'd probably... Yeah, that would probably be without the setback. So just average brawl.
Okay.
You can use another story point if you want.
No, that's fine.
Oh. he's got you. He's going to roll you over. And you okay with getting cuffed?
Yeah, sure. That's fine.
Yep. He rolls you over, cuffed, and he's like, "Ah, you son of a bitch!" And kind of pulls you to your knees, spits in your face, like drags you over, and starts to call this in to the precinct. And at that point, the scene moves on over to the other players.
Oh, man.
Okay. The PCs are up again. One officer's down. You see two coming from long distance running towards you on their radios. And you guys are up.
All right. Henry, after looking and moving his gun over to the other officer, seeing him so violently throw Roof down, gets a little more reserve in him and a little more angry. And at this point, he's gonna yell, "Ruth, get in the car and drive away. I'll handle this." And then he's gonna shoot.
Shoot the closest cop.
Yep. What, the one that's a really like a viable threat at this.
Yep. Yep. You gonna aim?
Would that increase the yeah, I'll aim.
That'll give you two boosts.
Alright.
So with the pistol short range, it's gonna be easy with two boost die.
Alright. Success.
Six damage. So you kill him. So he's getting ready to shoot you, pull the trigger, and before he fires, what does it look like as you take him out?
So as he yells for Roof to drive away, he doesn't even hesitate, sees the officer's gun still getting leveled, and Henry is just going to let go another one with his honed training, and he's going to not be too shocked when he falls and keep it as cool. He's gonna again yell, "Drive away!"
And Booth is gonna visibly kind of jump from her position on the ground and just scared by the shot and looking up and seeing the man that pushed her down just fall to the ground dead. And okay, and she quickly looks around for the keys, trying to find the one who had them, see if they fell to the ground.
Yep, the keys are like at on the ground next to where he was shot, because he's getting ready to put it in the trunk or whatever. So it's in the ground in a puddle of blood.
She quickly snatches the keys and gets him from her position on the ground and runs towards the door, and she yells to Francis and Henry, "Get into the car!"
Francis is right behind you, and she uses two maneuvers to kind of open the door, get in the car, and slam the car door. She says, "Drive! Drive, Ruth!"
Am I able to get, like, get in the car and...
So, you can pick up the keys, as a maneuver. You can make a second maneuver if you take two strain to get in the car. if you take two strain, and then as an action, kind of start the car up.
Yeah, I'm gonna do that. I'm just, again, yelling for Henry to get into the car.
Give yourself two strain. Ruth is starting to sweat.
Her perfect makeup might look a little smudged at this point. This has been the worst night ever.
Yeah.
You consider dead Alan, the menage a trois, and the checkpoint debacle. And the two police are up at this point. They both close to medium range, and they both get behind cover, and they shoot at Henry, both of them, from medium range. There you go. That's going to be average check. No modifiers on the first one. That's going to be 5-7 damage, another 6 damage.
Oh, damn.
To Henry. What does that look like as a bullet slams into him?
Henry, seeing the cops heading to him, he's thinking about moving forward, and as he's thinking about it, he just feels another bullet enter into his body. Drive!
Alright, what's your wounds up to now?
11.
7 at 6, take another 6, so 11.
Right, wasn't it? Wasn't it 11? It was, yep. 5 plus 6.
11. That advantage is going to be passed to the other policeman. Going to shoot. Would you like a story point to have me downgrade my, or upgrade my difficulty?
You could downgrade it. I'll use one for downgrading.
Okay, use your story
point. I mean upgrade, yeah.
So it's going to downgrade me. So let me see here. So white pistol. It's going to be average check. He's going to have a boost. No setback. Upgrade proficiency, no. Downgrade proficiency, yes. Oh. That's another 7 damage. So it would be six wounds.
Damn.
That puts you at 17.
Yep, Henry is down and out.
So what does it look like as you go unresponsive?
He, just after feeling the bullet enter him, does the guttural drive and growl. He just feels it, another one pierce into him, and at this point, the thought of forward momentum, he carries it and takes one step and kneels and then falls as he's getting ready, like mid-kneel, and face plants right on the concrete.
As he fades, your vision goes black. Last thing you see as you look up is you see Ruth in the driver's seat of the car, and you hear the car ignition start. And Ruth, it's your turn.
Ruth, kind of observing from the rearview mirror, just watching, screaming at Henry to get in the car, sees him just suddenly kind of disappear from her vision after 2 shots. She holds back a scream, putting her hand over her mouth before looking forward, knowing that she has to try at this point. And she steps hard on the gas, pushing down, crashing through the barrier.
Do you have any story points left?
I think we do.
You have one left?
But there's Chandra.
I think you're going to have to probably
stop after you speed off, so I would use the last one.
So I'll use a story point to crash through that barrier and drive away with Francis in the film. Away from Henry.
Alright, I'll let you RP it out, and then I'll do a little closing wrap up, and then we'll call it a night.
So, Ruth, seeing Henry fall down, she hesitates for another moment, but seeing the police still approaching, she keeps eyes forward on the road and steps on the gas, crashing through the police barrier and glancing back as she drives away into the rearview mirror. And as she drives, I'm seeing Henry lying on the ground. She tries, just tears running down her face. And she stays focused, eventually driving fairly quickly away from the police barricade, turning down a few streets, and eventually slowing down.
As you speed away, you see the two other cops. They see Henry drop. One of them holsters his weapon, the other one kind of covers him. Police runs up to Henry and kind of kicks the gun away from his unresponsive body and starts to rifle over him. You can kind of see him on the radio. "We have shots fired on Fifth Avenue!" And he starts calling an ambulance in the distance, so you can hear lights, sirens. More police start to flood the area, Ruth, as you speed away. Camera fades and you see a police cruiser with Chandra Nadu. At this point, he's even more roughed up. His face is all bloodied and scraped. He's in the back of a police cruiser and it slowly pulls away into the night. And we will stop the session there.